Today's approach is going to be a little different approach than what I usually take. It is more okay. The idea was this was meant to be for final year students and early practitioners. So the stress will be on actually making sure that some of the basics are driven home well. So the first half an hour will be intense. Okay, so it will be more of drawing the basics and all that. Okay. Then after that, we will get into more clinical. But throughout, at every point of time, I will make sure that clinical correlates are going on. Beginning onwards, we go on writing the clinical correlates. Okay. So first and foremost, okay, it may not make sense to you right now why we are doing all these things, but half an hour later, it will start making sense to you. So till then, I want you to bear with me and just be with me and do what all of us together, let us start doing what we intend to do. Okay, fine. Do you see my video? I think you are only able to see my...
You're able to see your screen, sir.
Yeah, you can see my video also if you want, if people want. Okay, now I think you can see my video. Okay. So you can see my video now?
Yeah, both.
Okay, whatever. So I'll start off with anatomy and physiology of the vestibular system. Then we will get into the clinical aspects, and then depending on the video nystagmography and how the graphic conventions are that, so that whoever has attended this, from tomorrow onwards, you'll be able to read VNG. What exactly is VNG? How those graphs, what those graphs mean and all those things. Okay. So we'll go straight into this. Okay. Now, first thing I want all of us to master is the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. Okay. The convention scans as if which side is right and which side is left here. The general convention in radiology is, I think there is some chart. Okay, I'll not follow the chart. If there is something, please let me know, Sriharsha. Okay. Audio is poor is what I am being told. Sriharsha, audio is poor? Sriharsha?
Sir, now the audio is clear, sir.
Audio is clear?
There is a little lag, but now it is clear, sir. Please continue.
No, but if at all there is a bad audio, I can... If it is poor audio only for few people, then it is their internet. Sriharsha?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is the audio good now?
Actually, we are having little lag from you, sir. Your signal is showing little red. I think your internet is a little unstable.
No, if you want, I'll just go near the Wi-Fi, okay, to the router. Is it better now?
Yeah, better, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. But my internet is not that bad also, okay. No, if it is good only, we will continue. Otherwise, we'll make sure that this is rectified first.
You can go ahead now,
sir. I will do one thing. I will remove my video so that bandwidth is utilized only for the audio, okay? I will stop my video. So now you don't see my video. Probably now the audio is better?
Better, sir.
Yes, sir.
Can everybody follow easily?
Yes, yes.
Okay, fine. So if it is better, then we will continue. Okay, let me see. Yeah. So now I will continue. So the conventions that I'll be following here is throughout, okay, this will apply to benign paroxysmal positional vertigo also, is when you see a CT scan or an MRI of somebody, okay, when you see a CT scan or MRI of somebody, what you will see is that it is as if you are seeing from the foot end. So when you are seeing from the foot end, this I want you to tell me which side is right and which side is left here. Okay. So if you are seeing from the foot end, all of us will agree that this will be the right side and this will be the left side, correct? Sriharsha, voice is clear? Sriharsha?
Sir, yes, sir, it's clear, sir.
Okay, it is clear. So that, yes, with sir. That much, if there is no prompt from your side, I will consider that things are clear and I'll keep carrying on. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So this is the convention that I will be following throughout. So this will... deep into the...
Sir, again, there is a lag in the voice, sir.
Got it. No. Again, lag? Hello?
Yes, sir. There was a lag in between, sir, again. Sir, no, sir.
Otherwise, I can switch my internet to my mobile.
Sir, once we will try with the mobile.
Hello?
Sir, because with
this then I'll switch my internet. Give me 2 minutes. All this while it was good. When we did the testing, it was good. I'll just change my internet to mobile. Okay, I'll log out and I'll come inside. Okay. Drawings is going to be of following the CT scan convention of right and left. Okay, so what is the CT scan convention? If this is the front is the nose, okay, and behind is the occiput, and these are the ears. Okay, so what I'm going to tell here is, okay, I'm not following the chart. If there is anything significant, Sriharsha will let me know. Okay, please. Okay. And other people can please, I think from the host side, please disable all other videos.
Yeah.
And
I'm working on it.
Maximize, because I see a lot of people sharing the videos. Okay. So when we see this, in the CT scan convention, the convention is as if you are seeing the person from down, from the foot end. So if you see somebody from the foot end, this side will be right side and this side will be left side. So I'm going to start using that same convention right now and throughout. Okay. So this is what is going to. The first thing that we need to do is we all need to familiarize ourselves with the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. Okay. We need to familiarize ourselves of the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. Okay. We need to. Sriharsha, will you go ahead and disable the marker for everybody?
Yeah, I'm doing so. Sir, actually, you have to do it from your side, sir. You are,
okay. I have done that right now. Okay. Fine. Now, okay, so let us start drawing the vestibular ocular reflex arc. For that, first thing we need to see is start from the eye movement onwards. So I will start drawing the eye in the beginning. So I will draw one eyeball. Okay, we'll draw one eyeball. Okay, this is okay on one side. Okay, and then the eyeball on the other side. Okay, so we have drawn two eyeballs. Then what you do, we have to write the extraocular muscles. Okay, so this is going to be the right eye, this is going to be the left eye, and okay, this is the nose area. Fine, so this is the front, this is the back. Okay, now when you look at the right eye, left eye, we have to move the eyes right and left. We have the lateral rectus and the medial rectus. Okay, we have the lateral rectus and the medial rectus and the lateral. So this is the medial rectus and this is the lateral rectus. Now we all know this, the nerve supply of the lateral rectus comes from the abducens nerve. So the nerve supply of the lateral rectus comes from the abducens nerve. So this is how this thing comes. And now we have the abducens nucleus of this particular side. Now when we come to the abducens nucleus, so this is the sixth nerve, this is the abducens nerve, and this is the abducens nucleus. Okay, this is the abducens nucleus, and here comes a very, very important point, and that particular point is the abducens nucleus is a gaze center for lateral movement. What do I mean by gaze center for right and left movement? Means if the person has to look to the right side, using both right eye and left eye, both right eye and left eye have to move to the right side, means the gaze center is the abducens, means the signal initially has to generate from here. So there are actually four classes of neurons inside that. One is the abducens neurons and another is the interneurons. So what will happen here is the signal to generate both, move both the right eye and the left eye, both of them to the rightwards, is in the right abducens. Okay, both of them rightwards is in the right abducens. So what will happen, that means if the right eye has to move to the right side, the right lateral rectus has to move. If the left eye has to move to the right side, the left medial rectus have to move. So here this is the lateral rectus, whereas for this it has to be the medial rectus which has to contract to make sure that it moves to the right side. Okay, in the first half an hour is going to be all these things. After that, we'll go into the full clinicals. Okay, fine. Now, for the medial rectus, where does the motor neuron start from? For the lateral rectus, motor neurons start in the abducens. For the medial rectus, motor neurons start in the ocular motor. So this is the left side, this is the right side. For the right side, it starts on the right abducens. For the left medial rectus, this is the left ocular motor. If this is the midline. Now what will happen to this? The signal has to go from this abducens and reach the medial rectus. And from here, the ocular motor nerve gives supply to the medial rectus. So this is how. So if the eyes have to move to the right side, this is what is very important. This abducens nucleus has to fire, and this abducens nucleus will make sure both the right eye and the left eye will turn the gaze towards the right side. This is very important to draw the vestibular ocular reflex arcs. This is the first component. Next component. Now what will happen when do you want both right eye and left eye to move to the right side? In the normal vestibular ocular reflex, the vestibular ocular reflex is a compensatory movement for head movement. So if I am looking straight, I'll just start my video. Okay, if the internet is good, I am allowed to start my video. Okay, so in a normal thing, what should happen is, if when my head moves to the left side, the eye should move to the right side. When my head moves to the left, the eye should move to the right side so that I can still maintain the gaze to one side. So what is supposed to happen at that particular time when my head is moves to the right side means, I mean, to the left side means, when my head moves to the left side, it is the left side inner ear, that is the horizontal semicircular canal, that gets stimulated. So what will happen? We have the inner ear here. On the left side, we have the inner ear. Okay. So the left side inner ear onwards, from there, what we get is, from this inner ear, horizontal semicircular canal, there the signals get generated, and these signals reach the vestibular nucleus of which side? Of the left side. So the signals reach the positive, this thing, of the left side movement is detected here and reaches the vestibular nucleus of the opposite side. Now, when they reach the vestibular nucleus of the opposite side, from there, the signal has to cross over. Now, what has happened? When I move my head to the left, the eyes have to move to the right. So the left-sided, what is happening? The left-sided vestibular nucleus is excited, but the left-sided vestibular nucleus excitement has to be conveyed to which side to move the eye to the right side? It has to be conveyed. For the right gaze, the gaze center is the right abducens. Right gaze of both right eye and the left eye, the gaze center is the right abducens. Therefore, left vestibular nucleus has to communicate to the right side through this pathway. Okay. So from here, the signal goes here. In the abducens, the signal is generated, and the signal generated in the abducens will make sure that this will go to the right lateral rectus, and this will cross over, go to the oculomotor nucleus, and from there to the medial rectus. So this is the complete vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. Okay. And this with the final year people in mind, when you write the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc, please note this one particular thing. Even textbooks also don't sometimes make a mistake in this particular thing. So be careful. The vestibular nucleus on one side, there is a crossing over, and there is another crossing over, and medial longitudinal fasciculus goes up. So there is this double crossing you have to represent when you write the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. Okay, this is the basic vestibulo-ocular reflex arc that we have to see. I hope that all of us are drawing with me so that we know what is happening. Okay, that is one thing. The next thing is, okay, the next thing that we should practice is, okay, please bear with me for the first half an hour. After that, it is going to be super exciting because we would have become very, very strong in the basics. So now we know a concept called gaze center. Okay, we know a concept called gaze center, and we also know something about the crossing of pathway to the opposite side for the action to happen. So we know the gaze center for lateral gaze is the abducens nucleus, and now we also know to bring about a lateral gaze or bring about a lateral movement, the medial vestibular nucleus has to make a contact with the abducens nucleus of the opposite side. Okay, so this much we all know. Now we will just proceed a little further. Now we will proceed a little further and go and master a few more things. Okay, now we will see the nerve supply of the inner ear. When you talk about the nerve supply of the inner ear, and there are some, okay, all of us know a gross nerve supply, but then there are some small nuances which are there, which I will be telling here. So when you talk about the nerve supply of the inner ear, so we have, what are all the things that are there? We have the superior semicircular canal or anterior semicircular canal. Okay, we have the superior semicircular canal. Then we have the horizontal semicircular canal. Okay, we have the superior semicircular canal, and then, so we have the superior or anterior semicircular canal. Then we have the horizontal semicircular canal. Please do with me, okay? Because this 1 hour or 2 hours have to be proper learning experiences, okay? Then we have the utricle. Then we have the posterior semicircular canal, and of course the saccule. Now, we have to see the nerve supply of each of these things. Okay, so superior semicircular canal, I'll just take a different color. Superior semicircular canal, the horizontal semicircular canal, and the utricle, all of these things, the supply comes from one particular nerve. Which is that nerve? That is the superior division, okay, of the vestibular, or the superior vestibular nerve. The posterior semicircular canal and the saccule, okay, posterior semicircular canal and this saccule get its nerve supply from the posterior semicircular canal, and the saccule gets its nerve supply from the inferior vestibular nerve. Okay, so here when you see this thing, but there is one thing here, okay, one nuance here that we have to notice. The nerve that supplies the utricle, this branch, also gives one tendril which supplies the saccule. So saccule has a dual supply. Saccule has a dual supply, which means it gets a supply from the superior vestibular nerve as well as the inferior vestibular nerve. So this is the superior and this is the inferior vestibular nerve. So the saccule gets a supply from both the superior and inferior vestibular nerve. That is one part. Then there is another nuance that all of us should note. Okay, that is, okay, if there is something significant that I need to know, or please let me know, because a lot of chat is happening, so I don't know what. Okay, if there is something that I need to be noting, please let me know. Okay,
we will inform you, sir. There's nothing.
Oh, yeah, yeah, please.
Yeah.
So the superior and inferior vestibular, so much we know. So the first nuance I want everybody to notice is the saccule has a dual supply, that is one from the inferior vestibular and a little bit from the utricular supply. So what is the clinical significance? Even in superior vestibular neuritis, we expect the CVM to be, CVM, which basically is supposed to be testing the saccule, to be completely gone. But we sometimes see that it is not completely gone. Some amount of it is still present. So the reason for that is the dual supply, that there is some amount of supply from the superior, you expect the in the superior vestibular, okay, neuritis, you expect this CVM to be completely normal, but we don't see completely normal. We see some amount of depression of that also. Because of the dual supply, because part of the nerve supply comes from above also. Okay, please pardon that and make that correction. I just, there was a in the thought process there was some confusion. Okay, so please make note of that. Okay, so there is a dual supply to the saccule. Now that much. Coming, the next thing that we all should know is that we have the facial nerve. Okay, we have the facial nerve nucleus. Okay, so we have the facial nerve and we have the ganglion. What is the ganglion of the facial nerve part? We have the geniculate ganglion of the facial nerve. Okay, from the geniculate ganglion of the facial nerve, which goes on top. Okay, those, we have the facial nerve here. Okay, so from the geniculate ganglion of the facial nerve, okay, what we have is, we have some branches which go to the superior vestibular and also some branches which go to the inferior vestibular, and then below we have the cochlear nerve and some branches which go to the cochlear. So we have branches from the geniculate ganglion which go to the superior vestibular nerve, which go to the inferior vestibular nerve, and which go to the cochlear nerve. So these are the anastomosis which are present. So what is commonly known as the, when there is a geniculate ganglionitis, what is the common name for geniculate ganglionitis, which is more easily known, is geniculate ganglionitis is more commonly known as, is it not known as Ramsey-Hunt syndrome? Okay. So the moment we know this anatomy, we can explain all the things that happen in the Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. The facial paralysis, the vertigo, the hearing loss, and so many of those things because of this particular anastomosis. Okay, fine. Now, one more thing. From the saccular nerve, one division from the saccular nerve, a little bit, just before it enters the saccule, one anastomosis will leave that, and then it will come and make contact with the
cochlear nerve, okay, which will come and supply the cochlear nerve. This is the nerve, okay, this is what is called as Wurtz anastomosis. This is called as Wurtz anastomosis. Wurtz anastomosis. Okay, so what is the clinical significance of Wurtz? As of now, it is not very well known. Okay, but probably this is supposed to contain the efferents to the cochlea. Efferents to the cochlea. So if you see in vestibular neuritis, we expect absolutely no problem on the hearing side. But even in vestibular neuritis, sometimes you see that there are going to be some vague cochlear symptoms, a little bit of cochlear symptoms also to do so. So then we get confused whether to label it as a problem with the label it as labyrinthitis or what. We get confused why is the small amount of hearing problems we do notice, though it is clear cut otherwise clinically vestibular neuritis. Probably it could be because of this Wurtz anastomosis. Okay, this is the one. So this much we have done. Okay, now the next diagrams I want all of you to draw is next set of diagrams that I want of. After that, we straight go into the clinical aspects. Okay, is the blood supply. Okay, I want all of you to draw the blood supply. Okay, so when it comes to again the blood supply, we have again same things. Okay, we have the same things. Please write with me. Okay, we have the anterior semicircular canal. Okay, we have the horizontal semicircular canal. And then we have the utricle. Then we have the saccule and posterior semicircular canal. Saccule and we have the posterior semicircular canal. Okay. Then we have the cochlea. Then we have the cochlea. So when we draw the diagram of the blood supply, these three, anterior semicircle, see anterior, horizontal and utricle, when it comes to the nerve supply, it was by the superior vestibular nerve. When it comes to the, it is called anterior. So based on that, and this is called posterior, based on that, the arteries are named. Okay. So see this, there is going to be, I'll just change the color, blood supply. So anterior semicircular canal. The lateral semicircular canal, the anterior semicircular canal, the horizontal semicircular canal, and the utricle, all of those things are supplied by one artery. And that is will be called as anterior vestibular artery. That will be called as anterior vestibular artery. Okay. Now, this saccule, the posterior semicircular canal, all these things are going to be supplied by the posterior vestibular artery. Then the cochlear supply comes from the main cochlear artery. So this is a very, very easy way to remember. So you know all the peripheral organs. When you know the peripheral organs, you have the anterior, horizontal and utricle supplied by anterior vestibular, saccule and posterior semicircular canal supplied by posterior. Please note that the nerve supply also and the blood supply almost is mimicking, and that is why so much of difficulty in finding out whether something is a neuritis or a vascular phenomenon or an infarct in these kind of things. Now this main cochlear artery and the posterior vestibular artery, both of them are branches of this main cochlear artery and the posterior vestibular artery. Both of these things are actually branches of what? Both of these things are branches of something called common cochlear artery. Okay. These both of these things are branches of common cochlear artery. Okay, so this is the main cochlear, then this is the posterior vestibular artery. This is the anterior, this is the common cochlear. Now, the anterior vestibular and common cochlear artery, both of them are branches of which one? This one and this one. both of them are branches of what is called as internal auditory or labyrinthine artery. These are all branches of something called labyrinthine artery. Okay. So this is the now what is this labyrinthine artery is a branch of. Now from here again we will start seeing clinical correlates. Okay, what is labyrinthine artery is a branch of. The labyrinthine artery is a branch of what is called as ICA. What is ICA? Anterior inferior cerebellar artery. So it is a branch of anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Now what is the branch? What is anterior inferior cerebellar artery a branch of? Anterior inferior cerebellar artery is a branch of basilar artery. So now we will start drawing diagrams here. Okay, so that we get a proper understanding of a lot of things just by this. Okay, now. You saw there is going to be right vertebral, left vertebral, both of them joined together, they form the basilar, and the basilar arteries finally branch and become the posterior cerebral arteries and join the circle of Willis. Just before that they give something called the superior cerebellar artery. Here comes the ICA, and the vertebral artery gives the PICA. I will start labeling each one of them. Okay, so on both sides I will draw, and this. So I will just start labeling. The terminal branches will be the posterior cerebral. This branch will be the superior cerebellar or SCA. This branch will be the ICA, anterior inferior cerebellar artery, and this branch will be the PICA, posterior inferior cerebellar artery, and this vertebral artery is coming all the way down from the neck. So the basilar artery gets a dual supply from the right vertebral and the left vertebral artery. Now here we have a clinical correlate right now. If at all for some reason one vertebral artery is stenosed somewhere along its length, okay, if it is stenosed somewhere along its length, okay, if at all it is stenosed somewhere along its length, what is going to be compromised is, if this is stenosed somewhere along its length, what is going to be compromised is that the basilar circulation will be dependent on only one sided vertebral artery. So in the rotational vertebral artery syndrome, what happens is when you turn the neck to one side, when one is already stenosed and blood flow is not happening and the only one side is giving the blood supply, when you turn the neck to one side, the only side which was patent, that also gets kinked and blocked, and because of that there is going to be a diminished blood supply in the vertebrobasilar circulation, and therefore you have so many symptoms. Okay, that is the rotational vertebral artery syndrome. So that is what is going to be the rotational vertebral artery syndrome. Now we need to understand one more syndrome, so we need to come a little down. So we saw what is this ICA. So this ICA, where exactly this ICA supplies this area. Okay, this area is, there are going to be multiple other things. One more clinical correlate here. There are going to be multiple blood vessels here. There are going to be multiple, these are all pontine blood vessels. Okay, so this particular area is the area of the pons, and then behind there is a cerebellum. Okay, this area is going to be the area of the medulla, and this area here is the midbrain area. So if at all there is going to be an infarct of the ICA along with ear symptoms, you are also going to have symptoms which are called as lateral pontine syndrome. If there is a PICA problem, it relates to the brainstem, in the brainstem to the medulla area. So there is the pons here, there is the midbrain here, there is the medulla area. So this will be associated with what is called as lateral medullary syndrome, and the superior cerebellar also gives supply to the midbrain. So if at all there is going to be superior cerebellar, there is going to be what is called as lateral midbrain syndrome. So all these kind of things, based on that, based on what are the brainstem areas affected. So what is lateral pontine syndrome? There is going to be facial palsy. There is going to be facial hemianesthesia of all types of sensations and crossed sensory loss. All these things will be seen, which are related to pontine area. So this is how we can compare. So this is the thing. Now we need to see one more clinical correlate. So we saw these are the vertebral arteries which go from down, vertebral artery right and left, which go and become the basilar artery. But where does the vertebral artery actually originate from? So we all know, where does the vertebral artery originate from? We know the arch of aorta. Fine. From the arch of aorta, we have the one side, the brachiocephalic trunk, correct? Then we have the opposite side, common carotid, then the subclavian, correct? Then the brachiocephalic again divides itself into one side is the, one is the common carotid, another is the subclavian. And the subclavian goes on to become what is called as the axillary artery, which supplies the hand, okay? Now, the first part of the subclavian artery, we have the vertebral artery arising. So this is the place where the vertebral artery arises. Now you know where this vertebral artery from this side and on this side, this vertebral artery, where it goes. We know the previous diagram from here. These things go all the way through the cervical foramen, all the way they go up into the brainstem and then they supply the brain. Now if you have a condition where this part of the vertebral artery, this part of the subclavian artery is blocked for some reason. Okay, if this part of the subclavian artery is blocked for some reason, if the hand starts moving, making a lot of movement, now what will happen? This blood supply is not coming from here. Okay, if there is a block or if there is a partial block or a three-quarter block or whatever, what happens? All the blood supply to this hand is not coming from here. So it will start drawing, it will start stealing, which means it will start drawing blood from the vertebral to supply the hand. So if that happens, then what will happen is, we know what is happening. If it comes here, where the area is going to be suffering, the area that is going to be suffering is the area up above. I'm just drawing on the side. This is the right vertebral, left vertebral goes to this basilar. And you saw the icas on either side, you saw the pica, all these things. So ultimately, where the ischemia is going to be there, ischemia is going to be there in the brain, in the posterior circulation. So that is why if this is this, so this condition is called as, what is this condition called as? Subclavian steel syndrome. Okay. This condition is called as subclavian steel syndrome. This much of basic, all of us need to be together. I know most of us will be knowing all these things, but then before starting the actual vestibular, this much of background was very, very important, and that is why I told all these things. Now we will straight away go and jump into the vestibular. You're all together?
Yes, sir.
Unlike in a classroom, I don't get feedback here real time, so I really don't know. What is
problem is we can't mute everyone, sir. It will be like a mess.
Ah, yeah, that is
unmuting. Ah, yeah. I'll reply whenever.
No problem. So as long as the things. So what now we will do is we will straight away get into the vestibular practice. Okay, to the vestibular physiology. Now that we know. So what all we know now? We know the nerve supply. We know the blood supply. We know the blood supply all the way from the heart. We know the nerve supply and also the interaction and anastomosis between the different nerves that are there. That is the facial nerve, the cochlear nerve, and all these things we saw. We saw how the nerve supply and blood supply are almost the same. That is why clinically it is so difficult to find out whether something is a neuritis or actually an infarct. So this much we know. And we also know the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. We know a concept called gaze center. And we know that right side vestibular nucleus has to make contact with the left side abducens nucleus to bring about that horizontal vestibulo-ocular reflex. This much. Now we will go take a deep breath. If you want, take a sip of water. Now we will jump into the core vestibular physiology. Shall we?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Now, take a break and we will start. Now, the moment we talk about vestibular physiology, we need to be 100% very, very clear about what the hair cell. What is the hair cell? The hair cell is a mechanoelectrical transducer. Hair cell is a mechanoelectrical transducer. What is a mechanoelectrical transducer means? Mechanical movement is going to be converted into electrical signal. And that is the core behind so many of the things that are happening in the inner ear. So we see the kinocilium here. Okay, when you see the kinocilium here, this is the kinocilium. Okay, this is the actual electron microscopic picture of the hair cells. Okay, so you see this tall schematic diagram. Then you take a section of this and expand that and see here, you start seeing the small ropes here. Okay, these ropes are nothing but the tiplings. These are the tiplings. So you have one tall structure called kinocilium and multiple 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so many tiplings. So you see a lot of stereocilia, and then there are tiplings. What exactly are these tiplings and what exactly is this kinocilium? Let us see a little deeper. Okay. So what exactly are those tiplings? These tiplings that we saw there are something like this. Okay, these are basically a protein called catherin, which are there, which extend from one to the other, and they are connected to the gates of these channels. Okay, they are connected to gates of channels. Okay, so what they do here is basically, when the kinocilium moves in one direction, when the kinocilium moves in one direction, I don't know what is happening. So when the kinocilium, so when the kinocilium moves in one direction, what will happen is it will start pulling along these tiplings. All the tiplings start getting pulled. So what will happen is, I don't know what, there's some problem with the controls. So what will happen is the tiplings get pulled. When the tiplings get pulled, what will happen is the channels open. Okay, the channels open. When the channels open, what they do is the channels allow. When the channels open, I think I'll have to do without the annotations, that they are giving some trouble. Okay, when the channels open, what will happen is this, the potassium that is there will start entering inside the hairs, inside the stereocilium. There is some problem, boss. Bear with me for 1 minute. I think I'll just disable the annotations with only the mouse I'll do. So this is the kinocilium. When the kinocilium moves in this direction, what will happen? It will start pulling on this, all these tiplings, and all they will pull on these tiplings. So what will happen here is, I'm not able to come back. Okay. Yeah. So what will happen is these channels that are there, they will open up. When the channels open up, the potassium that is there rich outside will start entering the stereocilia. Okay. When they start entering the stereocilia, what will happen is it will lead to change in the membrane potentials inside, that will lead to changes in the basolateral currents, and ultimately
okay, degranulation of vesicles, and then there is going to be release of neurotransmitters here, and that is going to set up a action potential here. So this is what is going to happen. Now, when you look at this particular channel, okay, when you look at this particular channel, even at rest, this particular channel is partially open. This is what we have to see. These channels are partially open. So what it means is, when the kinocilium moves in one direction, these channels open up further. When the kinocilium moves in the opposite direction, the channel that was partially open closes completely. So what happens is, each hair cell has a bidirectionality, in the sense it responds to this direction by excitation, it responds to the opposite side movement of the kinocilium by inhibition. So there is going to be excitation, there is going to be inhibition. Both of these things happen in this particular thing. Okay, so one hair cell is responsive in two directions, but in one particular plane. Okay, now what is this? Okay, what you are seeing here is a thing which is used by the construction workers, the masons, and that one is called as what? Okay, the construction workers, masons. Okay, so what they do, what they use this for? They use this particular thing for what? To find out whether what they are constructing is straight along the gravity vertical or not. What is the principle of this? The principle of this particular thing is that something heavy, when suspended along a thread, will always hold the thread along the straight line. Now, in the human body also, there is something. So in the human body also, to find out what is the line of gravity. So what is this doing? This is trying to find out what is the line of gravity. So in the human body also, you can use this principle of using something heavy to find out what is the line of gravity. So what you do here, we have the utricle and saccule, which are the otolithic organs. On top of the otolithic organs, you see these things called otoconia. These otoconia are again stones, what we call as stones, basically calcium carbonate crystals. What are they? What do? They start responding to gravity. They start responding to gravity. That is the most important thing. They respond to gravity. So which means, when they respond to gravity, what they tell the body? They tell the body what is the line of gravity. So this is exactly what the otolith organs do. Okay. Then there is a concept called morphological polarization. Okay. So there are two kinds of morphological polarization of the hair cells. So you saw an individual hair cell here. You saw an individual hair cell. The individual hair cell has a kinocilium on one side, all the tiplings on the, stereocilia on the other side. They are all arranged in a particular height order. Now, this is one single hair cell. When you see the combined arrangement of multiple hair cells, all of them show an order. All of them show the kinocilium towards one side only. So this is called as morphological polarization. Okay. So this is the morphological polarization which you see in this. Okay, this is the morphological polarization which you see in the semicircular canals or something like that. In semicircular canals, all the kinocilia are to one side, all the other things are one side. This is same morphological polarization. Okay, whereas when you look at the utricle and saccule, the morphological polarization reverses around a structure called as striola. Okay, so there is going to be this, around that the morphological polarization reverses. Okay, so up to one, all the kinocilium will be, all the kinocilium will be towards the striola in the utricle, away from the striola in the saccule. Okay, see here, in the saccule, the morphological polarization is away from the striola. In the utricle, these things are towards the striola, and in the crista ampullaris, that is in the semicircular canal, it is the same throughout. There is no concept of a striola in the semicircular canal. Okay. So what is this morphological polarization and this crossed striola structure? What power does it give? What power does it give is what we are supposed to be seeing. Now you know the morphological polarization here is along this axis. The morphological polarization here is in this axis. So what it means is, this particular cell, okay, if this is the particular cell, this is the tallest kinocilium, and these are all the small stereocilia, all these things, it responds in this plane. So if the kinocilium is moved like this, I want all of you to look at my video for this, not at this slide. So if the kinocilium pulls like this,
It pulls on the tip links and the next stereocilia, and it will cause excitation by allowing more potassium to enter. If it goes like this, it will cause less potassium to enter and will cause, this will cause, what will happen is, it will cause inhibition. In this plane, this will happen. But what will happen if the kinocilium is moved in this direction? If it moves in this direction, all the stereocilia, all those things which are less tall, all these things, they move en masse like this. When they move en masse like this, there is no relative pull of the tip link was in this direction, this direction, this direction. So if it moves like this, it will pull the tip links. But if the kinocilium moves like this, then the tip links are not pulled. So there is no response in this 90 degree orientation. When you actually plot this here, you see here at the 0 degree orientation, the responses are maximum in this slide. Okay, the responses are maximum in this slide. 90 degrees to that best polarization axis, if you do this one, you see that there is absolutely no response, zero response. Okay, like that. Which means, now in the slide that was, okay. So, if you look at this particular slide here, what you see here is, for the movements that happen or the tilts of the head that happen here, these cells respond maximum, whereas the cells here, okay, if I do this, the cells which are oriented along this morphological polarization will respond maximum. If I do this, this cell will not respond. Another cell will respond. So it means that each area is best suited for a particular direction of tilt of the head. And with the tilt of the head, the calcium carbonates are very, very heavy. They pull down and then they make the kinocilium to move. And that is how for different area. So different areas are best responsive to different directions of tilt. And that is why how the body will find out what is the side of tilt. Okay. So if you look, this is the diagram of the utricle. So on top is the utricle and below is the saccule. You can make sure, you can easily see on top, if you can see the utricle, it is horizontally placed. And on the anterior wall also, there are some amount of utricular cells. And the saccule is almost parasagittally vertically placed. Okay. So the orientation of the saccule is parasagittal and orientation of the utricle is horizontal. So I want everybody to remember, please tell to yourself once, utricular orientation is horizontal. Saccular orientation is parasagittal and on the medial wall of the saccule. Okay. Now this is the semicircular canal. When you look at the semicircular canal, I want all of you to notice some features of the semicircular canal here. See, when you look at the semicircular canal, this is the curvature of the semicircular canal. On the outer side of the curvature of the semicircular canal is where you see the neuroepithelium. And from there, you start seeing the cupula. The cupula can be considered as cupular diaphragm. Please understand and make a note of this. This is a cupular diaphragm. Okay, there are multiple studies which have seen the structure of the cupula, and it is a diaphragm. What I mean by a diaphragm, in the abdomen, we have a diaphragm. So diaphragm makes sure that abdominal contents don't come up, the contents of the thoracic doesn't go down. There is no communication. Similarly, in the semicircular canal, this behaves like a diaphragm. So what happens is, this side, whatever fluid or whatever cannot go to that side across this. That side one cannot come across this. Which means, when you look at this particular thing, if there is a otolithic debris in BPPV that is there here, that cannot cross this and go to this side. So if you see debris here, you cannot design a maneuver where you can push this across this diaphragm. It has to go all the way around the semicircular canal and fall into the utricle. That is the most important thing. Okay, so that is what we should remember. The other thing that we should remember is, so these are the ends which open into the utricle on one side. Then there are the other end also which open into the utricle. Most of the ends which open into the utricle from the behind, I mean into this part of the canal, they are all on the posterior aspect of the utricle. Okay. The ampullary ends, okay, are more towards the front of the utricle. So after doing repositioning maneuvers, the fear is always there that what you have put back into the utricle can enter into another semicircular canal. The best way of preventing it is making sure that the head is a little leaned forward. If you do that, it is not likely that any of those things can gravitate into one of these canals. That is the applied aspect of this one. There are two applied aspects of this one. How to prevent a re-entry or another canal entry into of this particular debris.
The other applied aspect is you can't, whatever is there, like anterior apogeotropic kind of and horizontal canal BPP, you cannot push the debris across this. These two things you have to remember. I'll deal with this BPPV in more detail in a structured matter in in the next. Okay, so this is what I want all of us to note. Okay, so this is something that we did in the beginning. This is just to review. I want to tell once again. Okay, this is one diagram which we saw. Okay, this is the anterior canal. Okay, this is the utricle. This is the saccule. Okay, you see this one is the superior vestibular. This is the inferior vestibular. The superior vestibular supplies this utricle, and remember, saccule as a dual supply, it also gets some amount of supply from the superior vestibular. Okay, now this is the inferior vestibular, and you see this is the Wurtz anastomosis, which go from here to the cochlear nerve. So this is the Wurtz anastomosis. Then we also saw the from the geniculate ganglion onwards to both the vestibular, superior and inferior vestibular, and also to the cochlea. So we saw that, and we saw how geniculate ganglionitis is also called as Ramsay-Hunt syndrome more commonly, and then how to explain all the findings that happen there. Okay, so this much is about the base. This is along with history and all those things.
Sir Srinivas, sir, you have some quality issues with your voice, sir.
Okay.
We are still not able to hear your audio, sir.
Yeah, thanks for unmuting. Okay, I dropped out of the meeting. I don't know for what reason. Okay, now what I will do is we will start doing another presentation. This is on BPPV. After that, depending on how much of time. Okay, I will not hurry up. Okay, how much ever is possible, let us slowly do it, because understanding is more important than covering the topic. Okay,
So getting an upper hand over benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. Okay. Now, the most important thing we need to know, can you all of you see my video also? Sriharsha, can you confirm me, confirm whether you can see my
video, sir.
And you can see my, you can listen to my audio?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Now, okay. So the concept is between what is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. You have to understand that what is a straight talk that happens in the inner ear and what is a cross talk that happens in the inner ear. For that, first and foremost, we need to see what are the three of the functions of the inner ear. The three functions of the inner ear, first function, which is served by the first diagram that we draw, is about the vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. What is vestibulo-ocular reflex arc? Something that starts, that I'm restricting myself to angular vestibulo-ocular reflex arc. It starts in the semicircular canal. It goes to the vestibular nucleus, goes to the ocular motor nucleus and moves the eye. Okay, that is the vestibulo-ocular reflex. Then we have the vestibulospinal reflex, which generally starts in the otolith organ. It is about gravity-related sense, tilt sensing. It goes into the otolith organ. From the otolith organ, it goes to the again into the vestibular nuclei and then comes down into the cervical and the remaining part of the spinal muscles. So, one function of the inner ears is to make sure that our gaze is stable. So, if I'm looking straight, when my head moves right, the eye has to move to the opposite side. This is done predominantly by the semicircular canals. Now, if I am looking, if I am standing straight and if I am about to fall to one side, I need to be corrected. This is done by vestibulospinal reflexes, which is basically the otolith organ. So, how the otolith organ does that? By, there are heavy particles in the otolith organ. We saw all those diagrams and all those things. Those heavy particles in the otolith organs make sure that our position with respect to gravity is known to our brain. The semicircular canal will respond to head movements, and it will make sure that we know what is happening in the, what kind of a movement the head is doing. So the semicircular canals predominantly drive the vestibulo-ocular reflex. The otoliths predominantly drive, it's not exclusive, predominantly drive the spinal reflex. So the semicircular canal moves the eye in response to head rotation. Otolith moves postural muscles in response to tilts. Okay, this is the most important thing. So what happens, how is this as happening, is gravity should stimulate otoliths. Malini, okay. Gravity should stimulate otoliths and head rotation should stimulate semicircular canals. How gravity is stimulating otoliths? Because there is something heavy. Why gravity does not stimulate semicircular canals? Because semicircular canals does not have anything heavy. Okay, it is the same. The cupula is of the same specific gravity as the surrounding endolymph. So there is no this thing. So gravity should stimulate otoliths and head rotation should stimulate the semicircular. This is the straight talk. Instead, a free-moving heavy otoconial debris in the semicircular canal makes the canal become responsive to gravity. Thus, what happens? Gravity-related tilts cause semicircular canal stimulation, leading to semicircular canal-related responses. Now, what will happen? So, gravity-related tilts are not supposed to cause an eye response. But if the gravity-related tilt is causing an eye response, that is not a correct response. That's an inappropriate response. And inappropriate response leads to perception of spinning and of nystagmus and perception of spinning. So, how do you find out which canal is affected? Okay. Which canal is involved, you can come to know by looking at nystagmus. Nystagmus characteristics tell that about the canal involved. Please write this down in red, underline, keep it bold. Because this is something that is going to keep troubling us when we are doing the positional maneuvers. Nystagmus should tell which canal is affected, not the position of the maneuver that you have employed. Okay, you may do a Dixalpike test, but during the Dixalpike test, if you see pure horizontal nystagmus, then the problem is in the horizontal semicircular canal, not in the posterior, though the Dixalpike test is for posterior semicircular canal. Okay, so the nystagmus characteristics tell about the canal involved, not the test involved. If a positional test meant for lateral canal produces a posterior canal type of nystagmus, the posterior canal is involved, not the lateral canal, and vice versa. Now, how do you find out which canal is in fact involved and which is the nystagmus pattern to be expected? If you see a torsional upbeating nystagmus, it is posterior canal. If you see a torsional downbeating nystagmus, it is anterior canal. If you see a pure horizontal nystagmus with a minimal amount of torsional is expected, then you start seeing it is a horizontal or lateral canal BPPV. So this is what you should remember. Now, for this, there is a small caveat. Reversing the position causes reversal of the direction of nystagmus. So what exactly does it mean? If you take the person to the down, so if you take the person down, the debris will start gravitating in one particular direction. If the same person stands up, the debris will start moving in the opposite direction. So if it moves in this direction, when you get up, the debris moves in the opposite direction. Going by Ewald's laws and clinical representation of Ewald's law, what it means is, one, what is Ewald's first law? Ewald's first law is whichever canal is stimulated, the eye moves in that particular plane of the canal. Because of that only, we got these three rules. Whichever canal is stimulated, the eye moves in the plane of that particular canal. Now, the other laws is clinical reading of Ewald's law is there is going to be one excitatory, one inhibitory direction, all those things are there. So if you actually read it clinically, what happens is the eye moves in the direction in which the inner ear fluids move. If the inner ear fluids are moving in this direction, eye also moves in this direction. This slow phase, I am talking about the slow phase movement. If the inner ear fluids moves in this direction, the slow phase also moves in this particular direction. So what happens? So when you take the person down, if the debris is going like this, when you take the person up, the debris will start gravitating in the opposite direction. So if it is upbeating torsional right in the down position, on making the person sit up, it is going to be downbeating torsional left. So when you are trying to find out which canal is affected, don't take this position. Use this position to read this graph. In that
your screen, can you share your screen, sir?
Screen is shared, sir.
There's a lot of you cannot see a screen yet, sir.
No, I'm sharing the screen. The screen is shared.
No, we are not getting your shared screen.
For how long it happened like this?
Last 5 minutes.
Last 5 minutes, sir.
Yes.
Then we missed.
I was assuming you were speaking directly. Yeah.
No.
Then can you repeat the canal, sir, again? Lot of
yeah. Now from here, which canal is affected?
Like we have to start from the beginning, sir. Once.
Yeah, this I will start. So I think this. Okay, I was under the impression that this this was being shown. So I will just again see. Oh, whole of BPPV screen not shared, huh?
It was my mistake. I was assuming that you were directly speaking to us.
Oh my God! Then I'll have to redo this. Okay. I'll come from beginning. Okay, don't worry. You have to please remove the annotations of everybody else, boss.
Yeah.
Disable.
I'll do.
Yeah. Please. I've done that. Okay. I've done the disabling. Okay.
So
full BPPV is lost.
Yes.
Okay. Then I will start again. Okay. I will start again. Oh, sorry. Okay. So now can all of you see the screen?
Yes, sir. Now the screen is visible.
Okay. Maybe till now you did not see the screen. Okay. No problem. Okay. Now let me start. So straight talk and cross talk is what I was talking about. The semicircular canals is supposed to respond to. The semicircular canal is supposed to. Okay. The semicircular canal is supposed to respond to head rotations. Otolith organ is supposed to respond to head tilts. Okay. So there is a difference. The semicircular canal brings about our vestibulo-ocular reflex, angular vestibulo-ocular reflex, predominantly. The otolith organ brings about predominantly the vestibulo-spinal responses. Okay. I'm talking using the word predominantly because, okay, clinically that is relevant as of now. Okay. So semicircular canal moves the eye. Otolith organ is supposed to move the thing. Okay, there are caveats to all these things, but okay, for clinical purposes, this is good enough. The semicircular canal moves the eye in response to head rotation. Otolith organ moves the eye, moves these paraspinal muscles. So, semicircular canal function is to stabilize vision by moving the eye in a direction opposite the movement of the head. Otolith organ is to make sure our postural muscles are stabilized. This much. If all these things are happening, there is no disease. Now, just imagine what will happen if the semicircular canal starts responding to gravity. Okay, so this is what I'm telling you. Gravity should stimulate otoliths and head rotation should stimulate semicircular canal. Instead, a free moving heavy otoconial debris in the semicircular canal makes the canal responsive to gravity. Thus, gravity related tilts cause semicircular canal stimulation, leading to semicircular canal responses. So ultimately, if you just stimulate cutaneous nerve, you use electricity, you use intense light or whatever to stimulate the ulnar nerve, the response, the perception is related to the nerve being stimulated. It is not related to what stimulus you used. Similarly, if the semicircular canal is getting stimulated, since our birth, semicircular canal getting stimulated means we are, our head is moving in an angular acceleration. So the body will think that there is an angular movement, there is an ongoing head movement. It doesn't know it is because of gravity. How semicircular canal becomes responsive to gravity? Because a heavy particle from the utricle becomes loose and comes and sits in the semicircular canal. And when the head tilts from one position to another position, that moves from one place to another and stimulates the semicircular canal. And that leads to semicircular canal related responses. So you're actually making head tilts with respect to gravity. When you made the head tilt, the particle starts moving from one place slowly and goes and settles into a new dependent position. During that time, the semicircular canal is stimulated. And that stimulation, instead of telling it was actually one small movement and tilt, but it is going on 30, 40 seconds till that goes and settles in a new place. Till that time, you start thinking that you are going round and round because a semicircular canal means head is spinning. And that leads to a perception of spinning and nystagmus. So which canal is affected? Which canal is involved? How do you make out? Yes. Endolymph movement takes place because of otoconial debris. That's right, sir. Okay. Now, which canal is affected? You make out based on nystagmus characteristics of the particular. Ewald's law clearly tells which canal is stimulated, that particular canal direction the eye will move. So if this is this horizontal canal is stimulated, the eye will move in the horizontal direction. If the posterior is stimulated, the plane of the posterior canal is this plane. Okay. So it goes, this is the plane. So it goes like this, this way. So the posterior canal will, or this side anterior canal or this side posterior canal, it will move in this particular plane. This posterior and this anterior will move the eye in this plane. So what will happen if you can for some time make my screen bigger and see my eye? What will happen? So what will happen if my posterior semicircular canal is going to be stimulated is, if my eyes, the eye will move in this, but in the plane of the posterior canal. So if I am looking to my left, my plane is aligned to the axis of movement. My eyes will look like it is going up and down, up and down. If I'm looking to this side, I'm talking about the right posterior canal. If I'm looking to my left, the eyes will be like this. This is the plane of the posterior canal. It looks like my eyes is going up and down. If I look to the opposite side, this is the posterior canal. Now also my eyes will go up and down only like this on that plane. But when you look at the pupil, it looks like as if it is rotating like this. Okay. So the plane is the same, but then because we look through the pupil, you look at on one direction of gaze, it looks like predominantly vertical. On other direction of gaze, it looks predominantly torsional. If you look in the center, if the person is looking straight ahead, it looks like a combination of vertical and horizontal. So this is how it is. Now there are, if you want to remember as a mnemonic, simple, upbeating torsional is posterior canal. Downbeating torsional is anterior canal. Horizontal is lateral canal. But is upbeating torsional always posterior canal? We have to keep one caveat in mind. Please see this. Okay. The caveat that we need to keep in mind is reversing the position causes reversal of the direction of the nystagmus. So when the person goes down, the debris moves in one particular direction, the eye is also pulled in that particular direction, slow phase. Fast phase will be the opposite. Now, when the person gets up, every moves in the opposite direction. So, the eye is pushed in the opposite direction. Okay. So, this is what the eye movement, one of the core laws in vestibular physiology is eye movement mimics the movement of the fluid that is happening in the inner ear. If the inner ear fluids are going like this, the eyes also will go like this. If the inner ear fluid moves like this, the eyes goes in this way. This is about the slow phase. The fast phase will be the opposite of slow phase. Okay. So, reversing position. So, if you make the person sit up, if you see downbeating torsional, you should think that, okay, when the person was down, it was upbeating torsional. That's all. With that point, that much in mind, it is enough. Okay. So, with that in mind, in that provoking position, whatever is there, you follow this and you will know which canal is affected, whether it is posterior canal, anterior canal or lateral canal. Okay. In the provoking position. Okay. Horizontal is a little more difficult. I'll come to that a little later. Now, right dixalpike. All of us have been told right dixalpike test is a test of right posterior canal. Right dixalpike test is not just a test of right posterior canal. Actually, any positional test is not a test of only one canal. It is actually a test of a canal pair. So, right dixalpike test tests right posterior and left anterior canal. So, if you can see two kinds of nystagmus possibly. Upbeating right, okay. Upbeating torsional, torsional on the right. So, this will be right posterior canal. If you see downbeating torsional to the left, that will be anterior canal of the left side. Here, I want you to just look at my video for 1 minute. So, here, what do you mean by torsional right and torsional left? I am talking about the upper pole of the eye. If the upper pole is beating to the right side, upper pole is, this is torsional right. If the upper pole is beating to the left side, it is torsional left. Okay. Just to avoid some confusion, Barony Society has taken up this classification over and above the classification of clockwise and counterclockwise. Okay. Because in counterclockwise and counterclockwise, patient's clockwise and the examiner's clockwise is different. We always use the patient as the perspective. So with the patient as the patient's perspective, this is the this is torsional right and this is torsional left. Okay, this is to the patient's right or patient's left, the upside. The up and down, again, the convention is with the patient. When this, you see, if you look at the patient here, the subject is hanging down. When the subject is hanging down, upbeating does not mean beating towards the sky. Upbeating means beating towards the patient's forehead. Downbeating does not mean beating towards the ground. Downbeating actually means beating towards the patient's chin. Okay, so this, it is all about patient. Patient's right, patient left, patient's forehead, patient's chin, right, left, all these things. So this is about. So the right dixalpike maneuver, upbeating torsional, posterior right. Downbeating torsional, this is anterior of the left. So right dixalpike is a test of right posterior and left anterior. Every test for that matter is a test of a canal pair, not just a single test. So though you are doing right dixalpike test, if you get downbeating, it is the opposite side, anterior canal, which is involved. Okay. So left dixalpike test, again, if you see upbeating torsional left, posterior canal of the left side. Downbeating torsional right, it is anterior canal of the right side. I want you to see both these things and start noting this number, noting this terminology here. Okay, see here. Upbeating, I wrote posterior. Downbeating, I wrote anterior. Torsional right, right. Torsional left, left. See here also. Upbeating, posterior. Downbeating, anterior. Torsional left, left. Torsional right, right. So this left and left, right and right is all correlating on both sides. Okay. Upbeating always correlates with posterior. Downbeating always correlates with anterior. So what does this mean? Dixalpike is a test of a canal pair, not just the posterior canal. Right dixalpike is a test of right posterior and left anterior canal. Left dixalpic is a test of left posterior and right anterior canal. This much we know. Now, which side is affected? We saw that. Always upbeating means posterior canal. Downbeating means anterior canal. Torsional right means right-sided canal. Torsional left means left-sided canal. So it is so easy. See the vertical component. If it is upbeating, posterior canal. If it is downbeating, anterior canal. Look at the torsional component. If the torsional component is beating to the right side, right canal. If the torsional component is beating to the left, left-sided canal. With that, it is very easy to note which one. So to determine whether right or left, look at the torsional component. to determine whether anterior or posterior, look at the vertical component. This is why there is that advantage of using the Bernier Society classification of torsional nystagmus, because right means right, left means left. Canal, right beating means right-sided canals, left beating means left-sided canals. Okay, Sri Harsha, there is some chat going on. If there is something that I need to know during the talk, please let me know. Okay. So there is the McClure Pegmini test.
There are a few questions, sir. If you want to take, you can take.
Yeah.
Sir, how can you explain the torsional and vertical movement in relation to inner ear fluid movement at the same situation?
No, both of them. See, ultimately, that is what I explained in the previous this thing. I think that it, at that time I was talking only with this thing. Torsional, the eye, according to Ewald's law, the eye moves in the plane of the canal. Now, when I look at the posterior canal plane, this is the plane of the posterior, or I'll talk about anterior canal. This is the anterior canal. This is like oblique. Okay, you hold your head hand forward. This is the plane. And when you talk about the eye, you are not, please give up the concept of the pupil movement. It is the globe that is moved. So if this is the eye, okay, if this is the eye, if this is the posterior canal plane of the right side, the globe is moved like this. Okay. Okay, if this is the eye, it is the globe that is moved. So it is like this. Okay. So if the globe moves in this plane, when the globe moves in this plane, if the pupil, if you look at my ring as the pupil, if the globe is moving in this particular plane, if you move my pupil to that side, and if you start, if it moves, if the globe is moving in the same plane, the ring looks like it is going up and down like a vertical. If you turn to the opposite side, the globe is still moving same, but the ring looks like it is making a torsional movement. You got it? The movement is the same. The globe is moving the same. Looking at the pupil, you feel, you get a concept of, if the eye is directed like this, you get a concept, you look like it feels like it is looking vertically. If it is looking like this, it looks like it is turning torsionally. But if it is in between, the same movement looks like a combination of torsional and vertical. So they are not two different movements. It is the same movement. Okay? It is the same movement. Okay? Just give me 1 minute. Hello? I'm in a webinar, boss. I'm giving talk. Okay, so that is okay. This was about it. Okay, fine. Okay, fine. So I think that is clear. Okay, so when you are talking about torsional and this thing, it is caused by one movement. It causes one movement in the eye. It is our perspective which tells that it is a combination of two movements. It is not. It is actually one movement, because we are looking at the pupil. When it is looking like this, it looks like a combination of, actually the globe is moving in one plane, and that plane is the plane of the semicircular canal. Okay, fine. And you can see there is a much more detailed 20 minute talk only explaining about that on Cyclops Learning Lab, Understanding Nystagmus Part 1. It is called Understanding Nystagmus Part 1, and I've explained clearly about these things for further details. Okay, fine. So coming to the McClure Pegmini test. McClure Pegmini test is a test for designed for lateral canals. So there are two kinds of things. There is a thing called geotropic, and there is a ageotropic or apogeotropic. So how do you do McClure Pegmini? The name of the McClure Pegmini test is a big name, but actually it is a simple test. Name is complicated. Name test is very simple. All that you make the person do, lie down straight, turn the head to one side, and then come back to the neutral position, and then turn the head to the opposite side. That is all it is about. So what do you see in McClure Pegmini test is that on turning to the right, if there is a right beating nystagmus, on turning to the left, if there is a left beating nystagmus, just imagine what happens to this subject here. She is turning to the right. The right beating nystagmus will look as if the eye is beating to the ground. She turns to the left side. Left beating nystagmus will look as if it is beating to the ground. So right beating horizontal on right turn, and left beating horizontal on left turn. Right beating horizontal on right turn, left beating horizontal on left turn is called as geotropic. What is ageotropic? Left beating horizontal on right turn, if it is beating towards the left, means towards the upper ear, okay, that will be looking as if the nystagmus is beating towards the sky. And on the opposite side, if it is right beating, it will look like as if it is beating towards the sky. Okay, so left beating horizontal on right turn and right beating horizontal on left turn will be considered as geotropic. So this is a direction changing positional nystagmus. positional direction changing nystagmus does not have the same significance as direction changing nystagmus non-positional. In an upright person, looking to the right, right beating, looking to the left, left beating is direction changing nystagmus non-positional. That is central. Here, this is positional direction changing nystagmus, which is not central, which need not be central, which can or cannot be, but generally it is seen. Okay, direction changing nystagmus is a concept. Okay, so please let me know in the chat if there is something that I need to immediately answer. Okay, fine. Okay, so this is geotropic and ageotropic based on what it is. So what are the these things is geotropic, ageotropic, simple. Right, right beating, turning to the left, left beating is geotropic. Turning to the right, left beating, turning to the left, right beating, it is ageotropic. That's all. So which side is involved side? Geotropic, the turn which causes the more intense nystagmus is the involved side. Ageotropic, the turn which causes the less intense nystagmus is the involved side. Okay, so you want me to explain this with flow diagrams using a semicircular canal right now? I will do it. Raise the hands, please. Okay.
Yes, sir. A lot of people are asking.
Yeah. Okay, fine. Fine. Okay. Now okay, a lot of hand raises. I think now I don't know how to disable that hand raising.
I'll do it, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Because okay, so now I will get into explaining that thing. Hope the annotation works now. Okay. So I'm taking up the annotation. So now this person is turning to the right side. Okay. Turning to the right side. So previous thing, I'm just following as if you are seeing from the foot end. Okay. Please think that you are seeing from the foot end. Okay. Please imagine that you are seeing from the foot end. If you are seeing from the foot end, which side is right side, which side is left side? Okay, excuse not so great diagram because I'm using the keyboard, not the... So if you are seeing from the foot end, this will be the right side. You're right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And this will be the left side. Okay. So you're looking from the foot end. When the person was in the straight supine position, what will happen here is, the debris will be in the most gravity dependent area, that will be here. Okay, hope you are all able to see. Sri Harsha, if you are not able to see clearly, you let me know.
Yes, sir. It's clear. Okay.
So this is what it is. Now what will happen when the person has turned to the right side? When the person has turned to the right side, what will happen is to this, I'll just change the color. When the person has turned to the right side, this full thing will tilt. So what will happen if all that thing will tilt? So this is what is going to happen. From the foot end only, again, imagine everything from the foot end, okay? Okay, fine. I'm sorry, I think. No, there is small. So when this person actually turns to the right side like this, okay, turns to the right side. Okay. This is what is going to happen. Correct? So this is the right-sided semicircular canal. Is that right? And this is the left. So this is the right. And this is the left. Is that right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So the debris was here. So the debris was here means the debris was actually here. Okay. Now when the person turned to the right side, imagine you're looking from the foot end here. When the gravity-dependent part is this area. Correct? This is the gravity-dependent part. So what will happen to this one? All this debris will start gravitating this way. Correct?
Yes, yes.
The debris will start gravitating towards this side. So the gravitating towards this side means In a circular notation, if you have to show, the debris is actually moving like this. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
In a circular notation, the debris is moving in that direction. It has moved from here to here. But if you make a proper circular rotation, if you're trying to draw a big circle, it is moving like this. Okay? Correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, so which means we know that the inner ear fluid movements, the core concept in vestibular physiology is inner ear fluid and eye movement is the same. Which means this is moving like this means this is the circular rotation means the fluid is moving in the front from right to left side. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Right to left side. Which means the eye should move from right to left side. This is the vestibular phase. Vestibular phase is slow phase or fast phase? Vestibular phase is slow phase. Correct? So the fast phase will be in the opposite direction of the slow phase. So the slow movement will be towards the left and the fast movement will be towards the right side. So what nystagmus you expect on turning to the right side? You expect a right beating nystagmus. Now the same person turns to the opposite side. Even the same person turns to the opposite side, what will happen? Let us see. Okay. I will draw the diagram. Shall we do that completely?
Yes, yes.
Okay. When the same person turns to the opposite side, what will happen? Let us see. This is the semicircular canal. Okay, opposite side. Fine. Okay, from the foot end we are seeing. So this is the, in the foot end, which is the right side? This is the right side. Is that right? From the foot end, you are seeing the person is turned to the left side, which means the top ear will be the right ear. The bottom ear will be the left ear. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now where was the debris in the beginning? We represented in the right side. So the debris was here. Correct? The debris was here. That was the gravity dependent part here. The moment you turn to the left, this is in the supine straight supine position here. Turn to the left. It was here. Now the debris will start moving, gravitating more towards the utricle. Correct? Here it went more here like this. Here it is going more towards the utricle. So on turning to the left. Now this means what? If you draw, I will change the color. Now if you draw, what will happen? This representation, if you do a circular representation, this is basically movement in this direction. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Means if I draw an arrow mark here, it will be like this. Correct?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So if this is the plane of movement of the, if this is the direction of movement of the fluid, I will move towards the which side? Left to right. Is that right?
Yes.
Which phase is this?
Slow.
Vestibular phase or this thing? This is vestibular phase. This is going to be the vestibular driven movement is going to be towards the right, which is the slow phase. So the fast phase will be towards the opposite side. That is towards the left side. Okay?
Yes.
So on turning to the right, you saw slow movement towards the left and fast beating towards the right side. On turning to the left, you saw slow movement towards the left and fast movement towards the right. In both the fast movement, here also it is towards the ground. Here also it is towards the ground. That is why it is called geotropic and it is called geotropic. But turning to the right, right beating, turning to the left, left beating, which means the debris is somewhere here. Now imagine what will happen if the debris was, instead of being here, the debris was here. Imagine the debris was here. If the debris was here, what will happen? It from here, the debris will start moving in this direction, just the opposite direction. If the debris was here, on turning to the left, it will start moving in this direction, just the opposite direction. Which means, you can just, instead of going full deep into this, we can simply assume
that right turn will produce a left beating nystagmus and left turn will produce a right beating nystagmus. So this is the full entire funda of geotropic and apogeotropic and why each of them represents a different kind of nystagmus. Now, can you reposition apogeotropic from here, directly make it fall into the utricle across this? You cannot. You cannot do it. You have to bring it like this and make a maneuver to reposition it. Why? Because of the this one is a the there is a diaphragm here. Okay, the diaphragm, that's a closed seal. You cannot push it across. You have to push it from here. Okay, I think this makes the McCleary-Pagnini test and geotropic apogeotropic very very clear. Is that right, Sriyasha? I can proceed. I can carry on.
Yes, sir. You can. No more. I don't see any queries on this topic, sir.
Yeah. Fine. Okay. Fine. So this is about that. Now coming to, so what all we decide? We saw which canal is involved based on this one. Upbeating torsional, downbeating torsional, and horizontal. Horizontal was little complicated. We solved that complication also. And now you know geotropic and apogeotropic. Okay. Now which side is affected? Okay, which side is affected in case of geotropic? Which side is affected in case of apogeotropic? In case of geotropic, the nystagmus which is more intense is the side affected. In case of ageotropic, the nystagmus which is on the side on which the nystagmus is less intense is the side that is affected. Okay, always remember, more nystagmus which side, that side is the more affected side. Okay, here the turn which causes more intense nystagmus is the involved side. And ageotropic, the turn which causes the less intense nystagmus is the involved side. The reasoning is different, is simple. If you want an explanation for why this is more, why that is more, that also I will explain. Shall we do it? Or it is okay? Shall we proceed or shall we do that?
We'll wait for any comments, sir. I mean, I think few people have requested.
Yeah, I think some people want it. Okay, so we will do that. I will explain that. Okay, I'll explain that. Okay. So I'll just make a diagram of one lateral canal, just one lateral canal. Okay. I'll annotate. Okay. And I will show. Okay. So, but one thing now, we all agree right now that based on the debris moment. Okay. So debris here, we considered as ageotropic. Debris here we knew from the previous destruction, debris here is geotropic, that causes geotropic. So let us see what will happen. When you make the turn, right turn, this debris moves in this direction. Okay. This debris moves in this particular direction. What will happen if this debris moves, this is right-sided semicircular canal, turning to the right will make this debris move in this direction. Turning to the left will make this debris move in this particular direction. Okay. So turning to the right side in geotropic, that debris moves towards the ampulla. So ampullopetal, by Ewald's second law, ampullopetal movement is excitatory and ampullofegal movement is inhibitory. And we also know that excitatory stimulation is much more than the inhibitory stimulation. Excitatory stimulation is much more than the inhibitory stimulation or inhibitory influence. So the excitatory influence is much more stronger. Therefore, this excitatory stimulation is brought about by rightward turn in right canal, in the rightward turn. Leftward turn, left canal will bring about ampullopetal or the excitatory influence. So excitatory influence is brought about by the rightward turn in case of geotropic. In case of ageotropic, which is here, the debris is here, the opposite happens. Okay, if you turn to the right side, the debris will start moving in this direction. If you turn, this is right canal, turning to the right, debris will move in this direction. Turning to the left, the debris will move more towards the ampulla. So, turning to the involved side makes ampullofugal flow, which is inhibitory to the lateral semicircular, which means it is less influence, whereas the ampullopetal is going to be a much more excitatory, which is going to produce a more intense nystagmus. Okay, so that much is clear. So that is how, in case of geotropic, the turn which causes the more intense nystagmus is the involved side. In case of angiotropic, the more intense nystagmus is produced by turning to the opposite side, uninvolved side. Okay. Some special situations, vertigo but no nystagmus on positional testing. Okay, how do you deal with it? Intense vertigo, okay, I mean vertigo but no nystagmus, not intense. Okay, there is vertigo, but then you see the nystagmus, you look for nystagmus, there is no nystagmus. What are we supposed to do? Okay, then it is subjective BPPV and treat it as BPPV. You can use the information from history and try to find out whether it is anterior canal, lateral canal, or posterior canal. But also you can use the positional test to find out which canal was the most symptomatic and treat that particular canal. Just if you want to go by statistics, then most common is posterior canal, so you can treat the posterior canal first. Okay. Positional tests produce intense nausea and vomiting, but absolutely no nystagmus. Okay. Vertigo is there. Previous case was vertigo is there, no nystagmus. Here, no nystagmus, vertigo, intense nausea, intense vomiting. Okay, too much, but without nystagmus. Then this kind of a picture is very much known in CVA, cerebrovascular accident. Please keep that in mind. Whenever that person comes with severe nausea, severe vomiting, but no nystagmus. Severe nausea, severe vomiting, severe nystagmus, all the three together, you are safe. Okay, or it can be migraine, but no nystagmus and all these three things you find, you have to weigh very heavily in favor of cerebrovascular accidents. No habituation, nystagmus or vertigo are same or worse with repetition of position. The rule in BPPV is, once you do a positional test, even if you don't do anything therapeutic, if you repeat the positional test, this person should symptomatically be better than before. But instead of that, if it keeps becoming worse and worse and worse, start thinking in terms of a positional vertiginous migraine crisis. It responds to migraine prophylaxis even with the flunarizine tablet also. You can abort it, or you can abort it even with mannitol. Okay, in case there are two mechanisms, one mechanism suggested is that it can be migraine. Another mechanism suggested it's a heavy cupula. Both of them, okay, they respond to either treatment, as either to migraine or to mannitol. Torsional nystagmus on positional testing, horizontal component more on lateral road, vertical component more on digsalpic and all these things, then you may be thinking in terms of light cupula and that kind of phenomena. Time course depending on underlying pathology. Migraine, repeated epochs every few months, sometimes repeated epochs every few weeks also. Each epoch lasting few days, which resolves spontaneously. So you have a patient who comes, who tells, sir, I had positional vertigo. 2 days, 3 days, it lasts, it goes off. Even if you, without treatment also, sometimes it goes off. And then after a few weeks, again, it comes 2-3 days, it lasts, and it goes off. Then you should be thinking in terms of migraine. The mechanical, where the debris is causing the problem, it is there every day till it is treated. Very rarely spontaneous resolutions are known, but most of the time it is there. Once you treat it, after a few months or after a few years, it can come back. Posterior cranial fossa pathology, here, whatever maneuvers you do, there may not be any improvement. Inadequate or no response to positional maneuvers, no symptom-free individual. See, what happens is, even in migraine, there may not be response to positional maneuvers. But in migraine, after 2-3 days or with migraine prophylaxis, it will go off. Whereas posterior cranial fossa, it will not go off. It will continue. Your maneuvers are not going to be beneficial. So if you have a person whom you have tried maneuvers not responding, after a week, after 10 days, it continues, that person you need to consider imaging. Now I will come up with all the positional maneuvers for all the different canals of benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. Harsha, a lot of chat is happening. Anything to be clarified, please let me know. Okay. Now, CIMOT maneuver for right posterior canal BPPV. This is the first position. You start off from here. Okay. Then the person lies down to the right side. If you're treating the right side, the person lies down to the right side. My friend, Dr. Pradeep Mundavalli, calls this as a parieto-frontal maneuver, because the first time the parietal eminence touches the cot, then the person makes one full swing to the opposite side and makes the frontal eminence touch the cot. So the shoulder works like the pillow, the parietal eminence touches the cot, and then you go full round on the opposite side head, and then make the person to get up. This is the Seamount maneuver for right posterior canal. For left, just change the direction. Guffoni for right lateral canal BPPV of the geotropic variety. The idea here is, this is called emptying the pepper bottle. You hit the bottle like this to empty. So what you do, the debris is there in the semicircular canal, you have to make it fall into the utricle by hitting. So what you are supposed to do, if the right side canal is affected, this is the utricle, this is the right side canal, you hit like this so that it will, the debris will fall into the utricle. So what you do, from this position, the person falls to the left side. So right canal is affected, falls to the left side. And then after falling to the left side, you turn a little to push whatever is there. Okay. So if the debris is in that particular place, you turn like this so that it will further slip into the utricle. So you do that and make the person get up. So fall, then the nose, one rapid tilt downwards, geotropic towards the ground. Remember that. And then make the person get up. Appiani for right lateral canal BPPV. What this does is, this converts a geotropic into an apogeotropic. In the beginning, what I told, cupula is a diaphragm. When the cupula is a diaphragm, okay, if the debris is here, you cannot push this debris across the cupula like this. You cannot. This is not possible. So what you are supposed to do, you have to push it like this and then push it into the utricle. So what you do here is, this is the right side canal that is affected. The person falls to the right side. When the person falls to the right side, this debris from here will start moving here. Okay. So it will start moving here. And so what this does is, this maneuver is not exactly meant to be curative. It will convert a geotropic into a geotropic variety. And then you can follow it up the next day with the geotropic if it is. For some people, we have seen cures also, but then otherwise next day you call and do the maneuver, the previous maneuver for the geotropic variety. Okay. So person falls to one side to make the debris move more and convert it from ageotropic into a geotropic variety. So the person falls to this side very fast. Then one rapid move, the nose lifts upwards and then make the person sit up. Okay. I have made a BPPV booklet. So whoever wants that can intimate Dr. Sriharsha. He can share that as a document to you, which only is about all the BPPV maneuvers. Full detail it is there. Okay, every maneuver is there, we'll for right, left.
Everything. Every registered participant will be sent.
Yeah, we'll share it with all the registered participants. Okay.
Yes.
I'm struggling with slide changes. Yeah. Now there is, if you are just starting off, okay, very comfortable with maneuvers for posterior canal, but not so comfortable with lateral canal, little confused, don't know till now whether it is right side, left side and all those things. There is one super maneuver. This is called forced prolonged positioning. Okay. So what is there in forced prolonged positioning? All that you need to do is, whole night you ask the patient to just to sleep on one side. Okay. If the right side is affected, ask the person to sleep on the left side. This is geotropic. Okay. Ask whole night you sleep on the left side so that the debris will slowly gravitate over the night and the person will be fine. Okay. Iacovino maneuver for anterior canal BPP. In anterior canal BPP, same maneuver for both right and left. What you ask the person, you make the person to hyperextend the neck where the occiput actually touches the edge of the cot. Okay. And then you wait for 40 seconds to 60 seconds and then make the person again look up like this. The chin touches the sternum. First is occiput touches the edge of the bed. In the next, the chin touches the sternum and then the person sits up. So this is Iacovino maneuver. So this is about BPPV. Yeah. Fine. I think I have towards the end, this is almost 1 o'clock. I don't think I'll be able to do the history and other examination techniques and VNG, everything in one may not be possible. But yes. I think instead of hurrying and completing, this was a better way, was my thing.
Maybe if there is an opportunity some other time, we can do the...
We'll do it, sir. Based on your free time, we'll reschedule it.
Yeah, whatever. Okay, whatever. A lot of chat is happening. I'm not sure what it is about.
Yeah, it's just congratulatory messages for you.
Oh, thank you.
Sir, and one more question. How many times do we repeat this maneuver, sir, during the testing?
See, generally, maneuvers are supposed to be one-time maneuvers.
Only one time. Okay.
Maneuvers are supposed to be one-time maneuvers. Okay. Lot of charts, if there are questions, we will not be able to actually follow that. Maybe you can direct questions either directly to me or to Sri Harsha. You can take my phone number. You can call me. I absolutely have no problem. 9901477600. 9901477600. You can call me for any queries. I will be more than glad to help you. Okay. Because a lot of the chat is coming and we are not actually able to follow.
Yes, sir. I missed a lot of questions.
Yeah. So, but then we'll be able to glad to one-on-one. I can always answer.
All the participants, sir, is available on Facebook. You can message him personally.
Facebook, I don't follow, sir. I just
okay. So then, can you share your email on your presentation so that people take a screenshot of phone number?
My email ID. You want me to? I will just edit it here somewhere.
So during the maneuvers, each step, how much time should we put the patient in each step?
The if you don't want to remember specifically, then minimum 1 minute.
1 minute in each step.
Yeah, in each step.
Yes. What is the role of vestibular exercises, sir, in the home?
See, the best is to do all these things under supervision, okay? Because we have seen a lot of nonsense happening when people try to on their own do their reposition, they put it somewhere else and all that. Okay, instead of all that, best is you do. Yes. Okay. Okay, best is you do that. Okay. So this is my email ID. Okay. This is my email ID. And then I will share the document about BPPV with you so yes. that you can do. I apologize that I could not cover everything that we intended to cover.
It was already discussed, no, sir. We thought we can, whatever we'll do, we'll do today. And
ENG, continue. Okay, syndrome specific history, all those things I could not cover, but at least BPPV we could cover.
A small information to all the delegates. Most of the sir's videos are available in YouTube under the channel Cyclops.
I will write that also. I will write that. Okay. It is called, okay, you can subscribe to this channel. It is called Cyclops Learning Lab.
And sir is doing a special series of webinars called Lockdown Learning. We are already in fourth series have been done.
Cyclops Learning Lab, that is there on YouTube. You can subscribe and you have a lot of videos there. Okay? Yes. Thank you all. Thank you so much for everybody for joining. It was a great privilege to have you all. Okay.
And
Vishal sir.
Yes.
Vishal sir's comments.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Hello.
Yes, sir. We are hearing you.
Yeah. It was an excellent talk, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Amazing.
Thank you, sir. Hi, sir. Vidyasagar here. Excellent as always.
Well, thank you, sir.
Hello. Sir.
Sir, Vidyasagar. Thank you, sir.
Excellent, sir. Sir, I joined late. Sir, how do you differentiate if there is two canals or positive, like lateral and superior? How do you differentiate them?
Sir, whenever we get confusing patterns, that is a possibility. Okay, that two canals are possible. Then we will have to see the combined vectors of the two canals and then see which vector is possible. Okay, sir. So maybe we can have a chat and then see. Vishal Pawar, sir, has a lot of such cases. Maybe we'll have a personal chat and then we can describe all those things. Like, for example, both posterior canals are affected in the head hanging test. Okay, you will get predominantly vertical. You will not get a torsion. Like that. Hello? I think Vidyasagar sir's This thing has
muted himself. Hello, Srinivas, sir. This is Dr. Dinesh. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Sir, regarding your pictures which you drew, regarding description of all those things, I have one small idea. I think it will do much better explanation. Plastic, like how we have this tubes, if you make a small opening and we put a small ball inside, and for the cupola, we can keep a partition. So, akkada ball pote, it will stop there. And like this, we can,
We can make this. Rotate. We can make that. That's a great idea.
Think like how small children play with that toys, that Lego toys. We can try and it will help us in a lot of way.
In fact, it can become a play toy for people to keep at home also and learn also.
Yes.
Yes. That's a great idea, sir.
Dr. Srinivas, can you hear me?
Oh, sir. Yeah. Namaste, sir.
Thank you very much for once again a wonderful presentation.
Thank you, sir.
I just heard this query about the tubes and the balls in the middle.
That you have made.
I've already made it. The model is already there with me.
Yes, sir. Sir, you can share them.
Is it possible for me to share it right now?
Yes. You can share, sir, if you have.
You can share, sir. You can share. If you can share your
screen. If you have the time, then I'll have to share my screen. Wait, just a minute. No, I cannot start screen share because I'm not participating.
No, one second. I made Harsha, just make sir host.
So if you remove your screen, then I can share.
You can. Hello. I'm stopping the share.
Yeah, if you stop sharing.
I'll stop share. I'll stop the share.
Just a moment. I'll share it. Wait. How do I do it? Wait. New share. No, this is not working for me somehow.
Yeah.
Screen. Okay. Okay, just a moment. I think I'm able to do it.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes.
I think I'm able to do it. Just a minute. Just give me a moment. Yeah. Here. Can you see the model?
Yeah, we can see.
Is it visible?
Yes.
So here you have the patient's, the model's head in the middle. This is the right side and this is the left side. Okay. Hello?
Yes, sir.
We're hearing you.
So you have the anterior canal and you have the posterior canal and you have the horizontal canal. And these two things are basically detachable. I'll just show you in a moment. Just give me another moment. If you can, just a moment. Okay. I'm not able to share my video right now for some reason. Start video. Okay.
Sorry, you need to reduce this screen so that you will be able to show that screen.
Wait. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get the model right in front of you. Okay, I'll stop screen sharing. And just a minute.
So you stop screen sharing of this one and open that video and then start screen sharing.
One minute. Yeah, great. So I'm back here. Okay, right now. You can see this model? All of you can see the model?
Yes, sir.
So now this is detachable, okay? I've detached it. I detached it from the main model. Just a moment. Okay, now here you are. So here, if it was to be like this, so on the right side of the patient, right? This could be the patient's right side. So you have the anterior canal. And if you can see, I've put some beads in here. Okay. And then if you look at this particular point, there is a bigger bed over here. Okay. There's a bigger bed over here, which represents the ampulla.
Mm.
Yeah. Okay. Likewise, you can see in the horizontal canal here, you got a bigger bed, which is like a block. It's like a full stop for the movement of the otocornea. or the endolymph. You can imagine these small beads as endolymph or otoconia, whatever you want to, you know, for learning purpose. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Srinivas.
It was great that you joined, sir. It is a great honor for me.
Always a pleasure. Come on, Srinivas. I mean, the pleasure is all mine. It's the privilege is all mine when I have the opportunity to ever be able to listen to you. You are my teacher.
No, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think Uday Banu has something to say.
Sure.
Hey, Banu, sir. Yeah, that model was made by sir only, Dr. Avinash Vijilani. He did it with his own hands, with one boy in Delhi.
Hello.
Uday Banu, sir. Namaskaram.
Sir, I don't know whether how I can speak or...
No, we are able to hear you.
Okay. Great presentation, sir. Thank you for, I learned so much from you. And I just, regarding this model, because I had seen few people from Mumbai, they were using something, you know, with a tube. They had made the knots and the twists with the tube and they were demonstrating. That's all I know. Nothing much, sir. It's a fantastic presentation.
Thank you, sir.
I think we don't have any more questions to take, sir. So shall we call it a day?
Yeah, I think we'll call it a day, sir. We'll call it a day. Vishal, sir, thank you. Bijlani, sir, thank you. Udaybani, sir, thank you. Sri Harsha, thank you. All of us and everybody who told. Thank you so much.
Sir. Thank you. We'll have a discussion and I'll probably...
I think Rohiwal, sir, is there. Rohiwal, sir, is there. I think without Rohiwal, sir, saying something, this is not complete.
I'll unmute him, sir.
Yeah. Ramesh Rohiwal, sir.
Hello.
Sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Wonderful. This was a very beautiful presentation. The basics made very clear again. It reminded me of the BalanceCon conference which we had and the movie which you uploaded on YouTube out of that learning sort of a session. Wonderful. My congratulations to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. Sandeep wants to unmute. Okay. Sandeep requesting to be unmuted. Sir, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Sandeep Kumar is requesting to be unmuted.
I've unmuted him.
Sandeep.
Yes, sir. Sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Doctor, we are hearing you. We are hearing you, sir.
Dr. Srinivas, I'll be showing the photographs of my model which everybody can make at his home.
Okay, sir.
During my talk, they can make these four models at their home and then can mimic all the maneuvers. So during my talk, I will show all these photographs and sure, that also.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Harsha?
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Dr. Harsha, will this talk be available in YouTube?
Yes, sir. We'll post it.
Yeah, hello.
Join late, so we want to see the feed.
Hello.
You know who is speaking, sir?
Dr. Vatwe from Kolhapur.
Yes, sir. Please.
I want to speak to Srinivas.
Yes.
Sir.
Hello. Hi, Dr. Vatwe from Kolhapur. Yes, sir. Yeah.
I know, sir. How are you, sir?
I am fine. How are you?
I am super.
It was a nice talk, indeed.
Thank you, sir.
One question I wanted to ask you.
Yes, sir.
Many times you advise people after the manual. Yes, to be supine for about a week, not to move.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Is it correct?
Sir, actually, I don't give this thing, sir. I don't give restrictions, sir. I generally prefer them to walk around.
Okay. No, while sleeping, we advise not to move also.
But then are my friends, my very close friends whom I work with very closely, huh. They believe in restrictions. And in restrictions, my friends believe. Naveen is there, Dr. Devi Prasan is there. They believe in restrictions and they actually give restrictions.
Yeah.
Okay. But personally, I don't give restrictions. But then no harm in giving or not giving.
No, whether there is any theoretical explanation for that?
Sir, actually, see, the idea of giving restriction is to make sure that there is not going to be re-entry.
So whether it is based on any theoretical background?
Yeah, basically to prevent re-entry.
Okay.
So for that reason.
So do we need to repeat it if not advised to rest?
If the patient becomes symptomatic again, then we can repeat it, sir.
Okay, okay. So there is no firm this thing guidance on whether to advise not to move or not to this thing.
In fact, there are publications supporting restrictions more than publications not supporting.
Okay, okay. Thank you.
Dr. Satyakiran, sir, you have any comments to make?
It was really nice. It was great. You able to hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. What you said was really correct. It's not just about to complete the topic. It's about teaching the topic. And it was really, really great, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I think we have crossed already 1 o'clock. Maybe many people are waiting for some other webinar to join. I think we'll close it, sir.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks for the opportunity, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. We are thankful that you gave us your slot. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.